and president of the Foundation for Ethnic Understanding, Rabbi Marc Schneier, joins me in studio. Marc, great to have you with us.
It's a pleasure.
Now, talk us through the simple optics of a meeting or a conference like this, Israel sitting around the same table, if you will, with these Arab nations.
Well, it's more than optics. It's a celebrated reality. We've never had this situation of the United States, Israel, and the Gulf states all on the same page. And there is a consensus within the Gulf, I've heard this from major Gulf leaders, of their desire to establish relations with Israel. So this is just one more step in that process, and we're moving in a very, very positive direction here right now.
Why do they want to cooperate with Israel?
I'd say for three reasons. First, the common threat, the common enemy of Iran. Secondly, the Gulf is going through an economic transformation. There's a diminishing demand for oil, and the Gulf has to transform itself economically. And I've heard from leaders from Qatar to Saudi Arabia, Rabbi, with our wealth and our resources and Israel's brain trust and technology, we could develop the most powerful region in the world. And the third reason, that Gulf leaders want to strengthen their relations with the United States, particularly with the Trump administration, United States Congress, and there's no better conduit than doing it through Israel by warming relations with Israel.
So let's talk about that a bit more, because of course there is that idea of uniting against an enemy, a common enemy rather. But is there a uniting towards a common goal between countries where hostilities continue to exist?
The common goal is economics. And I've heard from Gulf leaders, you know, they've said, Rabbi, you might think we're coming closer to Israel because of Iran. That's number two. Number one is that we have such economic opportunities in this region with our wealth and resources and Israel being the startup nation. That's probably the engine that's driving all this right now.
So what kind of an opportunity is this then for Israel being at this particular conference? How should it be playing its cards here?
It's a huge opportunity. I think the state of Israel and its citizens should be euphoric in terms of the possibility of establishing diplomatic relations with all six Gulf states. And if I was to be so bold to predict and to project that I believe one or two Gulf states will establish relations with Israel by the end of 2019, and I believe that Bahrain, the Kingdom of Bahrain, will be the first Gulf state to do so.
With your experience, what makes you say that?
No one deserves this more than the Kingdom of Bahrain and King Hamad, the ruler of Bahrain. You know, in 2011, when I first met with him in the palace, he was the first Gulf leader to publicly speak out against Iran and its terrorist ways. It was the King of Bahrain who, between 2013 and 2015, led the efforts on the part of the greater GCC to legislate Hezbollah as a terrorist organization. It was the King of Bahrain at the palace who said to me in 2016 that our only guarantee for a strong, moderate Arab voice in the Gulf is a strong Israel. It was the same king who, 2 weeks after Donald Trump announced moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, who shows up in Jerusalem 2 weeks later but an interfaith delegation from Bahrain. And just maybe a month ago or 6 weeks ago, the foreign minister of Bahrain was tweeting, "Yay Israel for knocking out those tunnels in the north. If there's any country that has earned the right to be the first, I would say it's the Kingdom of Bahrain."
Why though? Why, Marc? Why, what has changed?
What's changed that there has been a coming together in terms of the Gulf states with the West, with Western values, particularly on an interfaith level. I was just in Abu Dhabi just recently, and I met the Pope. And the fact that Pope Francis now went to Abu Dhabi, and now the UAE is celebrating their year of tolerance, or the fact that five out of the six Gulf states, except for Kuwait, five of them have interfaith centers, and they have an authentic commitment to reaching out to the West and even to strengthening relations between Islam and Judaism. I believe where we have been successful, myself and other colleagues, that we have been able to enlighten Gulf leaders and Muslim interfaith leaders that you cannot bifurcate Israel and Judaism. Israel is part of our religion. Mm-hmm. Israel is at the very core and center of Judaism. If you want to have an authentic dialogue with the Jewish people, then you must recognize Israel as being part of our religion as well.
Okay, so of course that's, I suppose, the understanding that's needed from the Muslim side of the table towards the Jews. But based on your experience and the work that you do between Jews and Muslims, what is the biggest gap that needs to be bridged to bring both sides together in a more long-lasting way?
It's the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But what is so unique in terms of the opportunity we have here. If I was to contrast the Saudi or the Arab Peace Initiative of 2002 and where we are today, the Gulf leaders acknowledge that they need to have some skin in the game. In 2002, the Saudis said, here's the plan, Israel, here's the plan, Palestinians, work it out, call us when you finish. Mm-hmm. Today, they recognize they need to be part of mm-hmm. that process, and for the Gulf, to bring an economic dimension, particularly economic, hope and prosperity to Palestinians, they could play a very significant role here.
Now, senior Palestinian Authority official Saeb Erekat says that this gathering in Warsaw is intended to circumvent the Saudi-authored Arab Peace Initiative. Is that a founded fear?
No, I think it's only going to strengthen the Arab Peace Initiative. But again, the good news is that it's not just a comprehensive peace that needs to be worked on between Israel and the Palestinians. But the Gulf states, take Gaza, for example. The irony that of the six Gulf states today, the only Gulf state that Israel is working with openly and publicly is the state of Qatar, where Qatar is now bringing humanitarian aid and sustenance to Palestinians, not with the blessing of the Israelis, but at the request of the Israelis, in partnership with the Israelis. Perhaps that's the new paradigm to help accelerate this process between Israel and the Palestinians.
Rabbi Marc Schneier, it was a pleasure to speak with you and
Thank
get that
you.
Insight. Thank you.
Thank you.